Hello everyone, welcome back to my channel. This is Shubham and in this video I will be talking about the diverticulitis. In my previous video I have already discussed about the diverticulosis. So there is some difference between diverticulosis and diverticulitis. So you can check my video on the diverticulosis as well. Okay, so this video will be about the discussion of the diverticulitis. So diverticulitis is simply the inflammation of the diverticula. Okay, and diverticula is some kind of pouching or some kind of bulging part of the colon or some part of intestine which is coming out, right? So inflammation of that diverticula can be defined as the diverticulitis. So diverticulitis is simply the inflammation of the diverticula. So inflammation of diverticula can be called as diverticulitis. Okay, first thing, so this diverticulitis can be divided further into two components, I would say. One will be the uncomplicated diverticulitis and one will be the complicated diverticulitis. Why I'm saying so? Because some patient comes up with the uncomplicated diverticulitis, which is good for the treatment purpose. Because in uncomplicated diverticulitis can be treated outpatient also. So outpatient medical management can be given to those. Okay, so we'll be talking about that thing. And complicated diverticulitis will be coming up with some kind of complications. For example, any kind of complication can come with that. Abscess can be there, perforation can be there, fistula can be there, some kind of bowel obstruction can be there as well in the complicated diverticulitis, right? Now, this diverticulitis can be coming from, it can be coming from the result of some kind of perforation, okay, some kind of perforation of the diverticula or some kind of rupture of the diverticula. Fine. So look over here. So I said that complicated and uncomplicated, two kinds of diverticula can be there. So one is the complicated and another one is the uncomplicated. So complicated diverticula and another one is the uncomplicated diverticulitis. Right. So here are the two parts. Okay. Further in complication and complicate, what the difference? There will be no complication further. Here there will be the complications. What can be the complication? I will be mentioning about that as well. So some kind of complication can be there. Abscess, perforation, fistula. Okay, so any kind of complication can be there. Further, this diverticulitis can be the result of rupturing of diverticula. Okay, now coming over to the epidemiology. So if I will talk about the epidemiology, look over here. Now, epidemiology is interesting as far as diverticulitis is concerned, and it is quite similar to the diverticulosis. Why I am saying so? Because in diverticulosis, I told you that in the North American people, in the North population, the left-sided quadrant pain, lower left quadrant pain is seen in those patients, in such patients, right? But in the Asian population, it has been seen that right-sided diverticulitis, cecal diverticulitis is seen in most of the population for the Asian side, right? Asian population, they are coming up with the right-sided cecal diverticulitis. However, North American people, those populations are coming up with the left lower quadrant pain, okay? That is the sigmoid column, right? Because sigmoid column is located in the left lower quadrant. So left lower quadrant pain will be there. Further, I told you about the diverticulosis. 4% of diverticulosis patients convert or comes up with the diverticulitis because that diverticula further, if it remains untreated, it can convert into the diverticulitis. So 4% of patients can present with the diverticulitis, right? Now, let me talk about the risk factors, some of the risk factors. So over here, let me mention that what was epidemiology. In the North American people, okay, in the North American people, they are coming up with the left-sided diverticulitis. Left-sided diverticulitis. And most of the Asian populations, they are coming up with the right-sided diverticulitis, right? 4% of the population, 4% of the diverticulosis patient, 4% of diverticulosis patient, their diverticulosis actually further may rupture and it can convert itself into diverticulitis, okay, which is not good, right? So that is about some epidemiology. What can be the risk factors of diverticulitis? So let me talk about that as well. So let me mention the risk factors. Okay, so let me mention it over here. So what can be the risk factors of diverticulitis? What can be the risk factor of diverticulitis? You know, the person who are obese, as I told you in my previous videos as well, obesity is the risk factor for various kind of diseases, right? So obesity, people who are fat, obesity, lack of exercise, lack of physical exercise, right? If the person is having the history of smoking, if the person is having the positive family history of diverticulitis or diverticulosis, okay, so positive family history can also be in the zone of the radiation of this diverticulitis. And further, the persons who are using the who are having the usual pain in the body and the joints pain, and they are taking the non-steroidals, right? For example, they are taking the ibuprofen or they are taking naproxen or any of the drug which are included in the NSAIDs, non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs. If they are taking those drugs, then it has been seen that those patients are also are having the risk of having the diverticulitis, right? So NSAIDs use can also be included in the risk factors as far as diverticulitis is concerned. Okay, so moving further, let me talk about the pathophysiology, let me talk about the pathogenesis, how it happens. So what happens is that some part of the intestine, some part of the colon can come out from its normal place, and that thing we call it as diverticula. Okay, diverticula. If it is coming from the single side, we call it as diverticulum. If many pouching are coming out from the normal position, we call it as diverticula. Now if that diverticula is there, we call it as diverticulosis. If the diverticula becomes inflamed and get ruptured, we call this condition as diverticulitis. Because diverticulosis patient comes up without fever, okay, and they usually diagnose incidentally. Diverticulitis patient, they will be having the fever, they will be having the pain as well, okay. So that thing should be remembered. Okay, that point I have already discussed in the diverticulosis video as well. So if the diverticula or diverticulum will be getting ruptured, it will be getting inflamed, will be getting red, it will be called as diverticulitis. Now there can be further complications. For example, there can be abscess that can rupture. If that will rupture, perforation can happen, peritonitis can happen, okay, sepsis can happen in some patient, because if the peritonitis will be there in the abscess, you know, bacterial contamination can be there over there, can be there, right? And bacteria can spread and contaminate the peritoneum over there, so that's why shock can also be there. Patient may undergo septic shock as well. Okay, so that is about the pathophysiology or the pathogenesis, how the diverticulitis may happen. Now coming over to the presentation, how this patient will be presenting to you. Okay, so coming over to the presentation, let me go over this portion over here. Okay, so coming over to the presentation, now talking about symptoms of such patients, symptoms will be quite interesting as well as this patient. You know, as I told you that usually left lower quadrant abdominal pain is seen. So you can, first of all, you can mention that left lower quadrant abdominal pain, okay, near the sigmoid colon, right? Most commonly that can see. What else can be there? You know, nausea, vomiting, which is very, very common. With that, some patient may have the diarrhea, some patient may have the constipation. So nausea, vomiting, okay, diarrhea in some patients, and in some patients they may come up with the constipation as well. Okay, while doing the physical examination of such patients. So while doing the physical examination, what you can find? While doing the physical examination, okay, there may be some signs of fever. Okay, there may be some signs of fever, there may be hypotension, because in some patients there can be sepsis. And what is sepsis? It can bring the patient into the hypotensive situation, right? So blood pressure may fall down abruptly. So over here I would like to mention that there can be fever, so temperature will be high. There can be the hypotension. Okay, remember, a diverticulosis patient do not comes up with the fever. Diverticulitis patient do comes up with the fever. Okay, so by doing physical examination, you can find fever, hypotension, some signs of peritoneal or tender mass can be there. While palpation of the abdomen, you can find the tender mass. So tender mass also can be the positive finding of the diverticulitis, and some kind of peritoneal signs, some kind of rigidity or tenderness in the peritoneum. Peritoneal region, right? So this is about the physical examination of such patients. Coming over to the diagnostic studies, so usually these patients are diagnosed on the basis of clinical presentation. However, CT scan, computed tomography with oral and IV contrast, okay, it is the best diagnostic gold standard for the diverticulitis patients. So coming over to the studies, coming over to the diagnostic portion, so let me jump over here and let me mention about those points as well. So what will be the important for the studies? Okay, always remember, while doing the studies, CT scan with oral and IV contrast. With oral and IV contrast is the gold standard, okay, the gold standard for the diagnosis of the diverticulitis. Okay, so it is, I would like to mention over here that it is the gold standard for the diverticulitis patients. Okay, always remember that. So however, if the MCQ comes up with such situations that there you have to answer about the diagnostic studies, always go with the CT scan. Okay, what else can be there, and they can confuse you with the options like abdominal ultrasound. Okay, abdominal ultrasound is also the correct choice. Chest and abdominal radiographs can be also considered. Chest and abdominal radiographs can be there. Okay, this is also a correct choice. But if even these choices are given, you have to choose among those CT scan with the oral and IV contrast, because this is the gold standard. Fine. Further, colonoscopy, I told you in diverticulitis, colonoscopy was a gold standard in the diverticulosis patient. Colonoscopy is not to be done in the diverticulitis patient. Why? Because it may lead to, this patient may have the danger of the rupture of their colon, okay? Or this diverticula may further rupture by the colonoscopy. So you should avoid that colonoscopy in the patient of diverticulitis. However, after 2 to 3 weeks, after the evaluation of such patient, you may go with the colonoscopy if you are having some suspect of malignancy. Otherwise, you should not go for the colonoscopy in diverticulitis patient. Diverticulosis patient, these patient of the diverticulosis, okay, those patients who are in the diverticulosis, their colonoscopy was the gold standard. In diverticulitis, CT scan with oral and IV contrast is the gold standard test. Okay, fine. So this was about the studies. About the imaging, like CBCs, you can check over there. Over there you can find the leukocytosis, as there can be some bacteria if the abscess is there. So in the CBC findings, you may find in the CBC finding, okay, or FBC, full blood count, complete blood count, you may find the leukocytosis. So WBC count can go high, okay, as there can be some bacterial contamination in the body. With that, this is enough for the studies purpose for the diverticulitis. Coming up with the differentials. So what can be the differentials in such patients? So let me write over here. Okay, so differentials, you can differentiate it with the IBD, okay, inflammatory bowel disease. So IBD
colorectal cancer, and acute appendicitis, because I told you that you know, in some Asian population it can comes up with the right-sided diverticulitis, and there you have to differentiate between the acute appendicitis and the diverticulitis. Okay, next thing, with the treatment, how you are going to, how you will be treating such patients. So let me draw this over here, or let me mention over here, how can you treat such patients. So treatment over here, which is very important. Okay, and in the beginning of this video I told you that diverticulitis can be differentiated. For easy studying of this topic, you can differentiate into two parts, diverticulitis, uncomplicated and the complicated. Now, uncomplicated, I told you, this is much easiest, this is much good for the health of the patient, because uncomplicated diverticulitis can be treated outpatient management, by outpatient management also. Now, what is the outpatient management and what is the inpatient? Outpatient management, that we can discharge the patient from the hospital, and we will be prescribing them antibiotics, or antibiotics which he can take, he or she can take at his home, at his or her home, right? So in uncomplicated diverticulitis, in which there is no further complications like abscess, perforation, there is nothing like that, in such situations you may discharge the patient and you may go with the outpatient treatment of such patients. So in those conditions you may go with the oral antibiotics for about 7 to 10 days and ask the patient to come again to visit visit your clinic again after 2 to 3 days, right? So in the treatment, you can say for the uncomplicated diverticulitis, oral antibiotics can be given. Oral antibiotics for 7 to 10 days. Okay, this was for the uncomplicated diverticulitis. So uncomplicated diverticulitis. Okay, however, for the complicated diverticulitis, this is quite complicated actually. Now, you know, for the complicated diverticulitis, you have to go with the IV antibiotics, you have to go with the parenteral pain medication, because the person will be in the pain. So inpatient medical management will be there, not outpatient. That was the outpatient medical management. Inpatient medical management, which means the patient will be in the hospital, must be in the hospital, and the treatment will be undergoing in the supervision of the physician, right? So IV antibiotics, I will say. So IV antibiotics okay, parenteral pain medication. So IV pain medication should be there, because patient will be in the pain, so parenteral pain medication should be there, right? What else can be there? If some kind of, you know, you have to give antibiotics, you have to give parenteral pain medications, the patient may have the depletion of the fluids, so you have to give them IV fluids as well. So I would like to mention over here about the fluids. So IV fluids should also be given in such patients, right? What else? At last, eventually, if the patient is not able to treat with such situations, such medication tactics, then you may go with the surgery at last. Okay, so the patient has to go through the surgery. Okay, after that, if I will talk about the complications, what can be the complications? So let me mention somewhere about the complication as well. So let me mention over here. Okay, so what can be the complications? So as far as diverticulitis patients are concerned, okay, I told you abscess, okay, there can be abscess, there can be peritonitis, there can be diverticular fistula, there can be peritonitis, there can be perforation, and at last you can mention that there can be shock as well for the patients, right? Shock as well. I would like to differentiate here like this, right? shock can also be there, because you know, diverticula, if the patient is having the abscess, and if this abscess got ruptured, then bacteria may come out and it can contaminate the peritoneum, right? So the patient may undergo septic shock and the patient may have the sepsis as well. That's why you need to give the IV fluids as well for such patients, right? So that is about the abscess. For the abscess, I would like to mention some things as well. Abscess, this is important, because if it is for the uncomplicated diverticulitis, what may happen, that if the abscess, it depends on the abscess size. Now, if the abscess is less than 3 cm, okay, you may treat it with the IV antibiotics. If the abscess is less than 3 cm, okay, you may treat it with IV antibiotics. You may give IV antibiotics. Okay, if the abscess is bigger one, if the abscess is more than 3 cm, then you have to do CT guided under the supervision of CT, percutaneous drainage. Okay, so if the abscess is less than 3 cm, you have to give them IV antibiotics. If the abscess is more than 3 cm, then CT guided percutaneous drainage has to be done. Or if it is not possible, then surgical drainage of this abscess has to be done. Okay, so that was about the diverticulitis. And in the previous video, I have already discussed about the diverticulosis. So I hope this makes sense. Please make sure.